Hello everyone, we've got a few people joining still, so I might just give it a moment until I have a few more people. Okay. Hello, welcome. Welcome to the webinar. We'll start in a moment. Thank you. Okay, I have a few more on now. So welcome to PotatoLink, the PotatoLink webinar today on Dragonline, which is mobile drip irrigation. It has transformed pivot irrigation through drip technology. So this webinar is being recorded and will be available on the PotatoLink website and distributed to registrants once the session has concluded. PotatoLink is the Hort Innovation Australian Potato Industry Communication and Extension Project, which is funded by the Fresh and Processing Potato Funds, matched by government funds. While the project is managed by Hort Innovation, Applied Horticultural Research is the team contracted to deliver the project. My name is Steph Tabone, and I'm from Applied Horticultural Research, and I'll be facilitating our webinar today. So I'd like to introduce a few of our speakers today. On the line, we have Monty Teeter, Tetaan Henning, Mark Heap, Michael Ask, and also Peter O'Brien. So I'll just give them a brief introduction. So Monty Teeter is the developer and CEO of Dragonline, and he's dialing in today from the US. He's been a distributor, designer, and installer of center pivots for over 40 years and has had experience with subsurface drip irrigation for 20 years. Monty observed water supply challenges in his region and became determined to identify ways to conserve and use water more efficiently. He worked hard on a range of different developments in irrigation and combined his knowledge and experience with both pivots and subsurface drip irrigation, beginning his quest to develop Dragonline. So we welcome Monty.
Thank you.
Tetaan Henning is the Director of Eco Water Management, which he started in 2018 to bring global, innovative and environmentally friendly technologies to the agricultural industry here in Australia. So knowing as a farmer himself, water is a difficult commodity to manage due to the ever-changing climate issues we face today. So he set out to look for opportunities to save water and store water in a sustainable way. And Monty and Tetaan is a provider of Dragonline in Australia. Also on the line, Mark Heap has worked as a potato agronomist and bioscientist for 35 years and the last 23 years with Simplot. His experience includes processing potato production in China, India, and Australia. In his current role of bioscience manager, Mark has contributed to new variety development, improved potato seed systems, and the efficient use of water. Peter O'Brien is our regional coordinator, national coordinator of the project. And I believe Michael Ask is also joining from Dragonline today. So we welcome all of our presenters. So just a bit of context, after 3 years of La Nina driving excessive wet conditions in Australia, the Bureau of Meteorology have issued an El Nino watch. So while El Nino Southern Oscillation is currently neutral, El Nino watch indicates an increased risk of El Nino occurring, which is typically associated with lower than average winter and spring rainfall over most of eastern Australia. In addition, with the rising cost of energy and other farm inputs, it seems appropriate to consider other technologies that can improve not only water efficiency, but also reduce operating costs. So it's very timely that we're talking about these kind of technologies today. So on the agenda, Tetaan and Monty are going to introduce Dragonline, outlining what it is, how it works, and have a range of photos and videos to demonstrate. They will then explore the benefits that are experienced when using the technology and will identify situations for best use and how the technology can be adapted to existing irrigation systems. Mark is then going to share his experience with Dragonline in potatoes at Simplot, recognizing the benefits and learnings experienced. So a few housekeeping things, please pop any questions you have in the Q&A function or raise your hand and we can pop you off mute. And at the end of the webinar, I'll provide a brief update on some upcoming events that we have that you might be interested in. So with that, I'm going to hand over to Tetaan and Monty to start our webinar today.
Thank you, Steph, and thank you for inviting us to this webinar. Just to back up of what Steph said there, Monty invented Dragonline. It's 10 years ago now in the US. And the main objective was there was, the water sources in Kansas started drying up. They looked at solutions just to keep their hills up and keep on watering with different technologies, and Monty invented Dragonline. Monty, I don't know if you want to just give a little bit of background about how you got onto Dragonline and where it is today.
Okay, I'd be happy to. Sometimes when people hear the word drip irrigation, they say, I've tried that before. I don't think I want to work with it. And going into this venture many years ago, there's been other people try to adapt or invent the use of drip irrigation with center pivots. And until probably 12 years ago, sometimes technology catches up with ideas as we were selling other drip systems. And I'd always try to look at trying to adapt to a pivot, because we always knew we got 30 to 40% better use of the water with our drip systems than we did with pivots. And pivots cause so many problems with wheel tracks, water runoff, crusting, germination issues, wheel tracks, just keeping pivots running sometimes is a difficult challenge. So, if we could solve those problems of all the issues I just talked about with utilizing drip irrigation, it would mean that we would want something that would be practical to use, easy to operate, easy to manage. And so that was the hurdles that we had to go across make something better than what's been made in the past. Probably the biggest invention that we had, not to take a whole lot of time here, is the pressure compensating emitter, which means every emitter in the tubing is regulated to let out the precise amount of water. Once you reach 10 PSI, or I think it's about, 0.5 bar, I guess it'd be 0.7 bar, every emitter on the complete system is putting out exactly the same water. And it's very precise, plus or minus 2% flow variation up to 4 bar. So with that invention of that emitter, it made it possible then to adapt it to our system, because we have undulating terrain, we have ups and downs with the hoses on pivots and span configurations. And then also we developed a 2 gallon an hour emitter, which is 10 times larger than your traditional subsurface drip emitters, to help eliminate plugging and issues that might happen with filtration. So with Dragonline, we developed it to use half the filtration that's required. We have a 10 times larger emitter, and we patented several uses of the manifold that we adapt or make any spacing to fit any row spacing on your pivot or that you plant on. And then with the winch system, we can move it right or left up to 30 inches, I think, or 76 centimeters, right or left, to adapt to fit the rows that you're watering. But we're here to talk about potatoes, and we've adapted as we go through the slides, and I'll try not to talk too much more after now and let everyone else talk. We have figured out that if we make the lines closer together to get more uniformity, we're about that, 45 centimeters, Tetaan, something like that, somewhere in that neighborhood, 45 to 50 centimeters apart. And instead of planting in a circle to have to change all the farming operations, we plant in, you can still plant in straight rows and we can water across those beds. But we do recommend, like in this picture that you're viewing here, a flat bed as we water across, so the water doesn't run off that tall hill. As long as you relatively have a flat bed, we maintain all the watering, have very good uniformity, and we have no runoff of our water. With saying that, I'm a grower and a farmer also. I've developed this product because of deficit watering. And then as we people find out what we're doing, we've adapted it to many other systems. But we've been growing potatoes now for about 7 years, but really here in the U.S. for about 3 years to really get a lot of knowledge personally. I know Mark's done it longer than that. But one of the growers we just visited with last year said he saved a minimum of 30% on his water, probably closer to 40%. He used no fungicides. He didn't have any wheel tracks. He didn't have any runoff. And he saved about $400 per acre his first year with the use of Dragonline, which paid for his system. So with saying that, we've come a long ways in a short period of time. And Tetaan, I'll let you go ahead and keep and complete.
Steve, can we just go down, please? So one thing we've noticed here, working with a few different companies in Australia with potatoes, a big challenge in the potato industry is drainage. And Mark will follow up on that a little bit. The trials we did and the projects we did with company in Tasmania, we found that we had a lot less fungicides that grew on the potatoes. The potatoes were a lot healthier. So the yield on the potatoes were a lot better as well. And we've sort of seen that across the board, not in the just in the potato industry, but cotton, corn, because you're not wetting the foliage and the leaves, there's less shock on the plant. So the plant grows a lot better. There's less leaf diseases on the plant, so less fungicides get sprayed. So overall, the plant is a lot more healthier, grows a lot quicker, so your yields are a lot better as well. Just go down a bit, Steve. If you keep going down, please, Steve. So Monty mentioned, it's a lot of question, a big question for a lot of the growers is planting in circles. With the ability for us to change our, adapt our manifolds to 15 inch or 40 inch or 30 inch, to whatever the grower's requirements are. We started with the corn and cotton and also the potatoes, running across the rows. So I had a gentleman phone me yesterday about the question was, can he still keep planting in rows? Definitely you can. That's the nice thing about Dragonline is each system gets custom made to the requirements of each grower. And then the focus is also on the next crop you plant. It's not just on potatoes. A lot of these growers grow corn or wheat or even vegetables afterwards. The benefit of the Dragonline is we can adapt that to your next crop then as well.
I might mention Yeah, I might mention on this slide you're looking at here, you can see that the dragon line always follows itself very precisely, each circle. It always stays where it's positioned. And this particular company has a diker that they dike holes to prevent runoff from the other sprinklers, but we don't have runoff with our system. And it may look dry in spots, but the water through capillary action goes down and moves sideways and comes out in those dry areas where the air comes out. So that water is actually pulled into the soil and air comes out. So it's wet. The wettest part is in between the rows. It's underneath that dry spot there. So just FYI, I just wanted to show that. And then you can show a little video. I think go to the next slide. And I think there's a video. I think go one more slide down. I think the next slide, we won't have to show two then. And that might have been the one dripping, but it just shows as it drags in the field, you know, whether you're going with the row or across the rows, how uniform they stay. And you can see how it drips there so slowly. We've made some improvements that doesn't spurt anymore like this one does, but it just drips water out very slowly, meticulously, and doesn't cause erosion or compaction of the soil.
Just to add to that, Monty, and very important for the growers is we found in Australia is to work with moisture probes to give you a better idea on what moisture content is in the soil. We've had occasions where farmers have overwatered because you can't see the water on top of the soil. So very important to implement moisture probes when you work with dragon line and the drip. Otherwise, you're basically flying blind. You've got no idea what's happening down in the soil. So very important moisture probes.
One question I might answer real quick, someone may ask, you know, what is the life expectancy of our tubing? You know, the system we have today, we believe is a 12 to 15 year life. Very, very, very little wear that'll ever happen because everything runs so slow. And it's a 50 mil product, which is the heaviest tubing made for surface drip irrigation. So I just want to share that, okay?
One thing we've also picked up, especially with row crops, because you're not wetting the whole surface area, germination of weeds are a lot less. Cotton client of us here in Australia, Finley, because of that, he produced one spray of herbicides. So yeah, chemical use are definitely less with herbicides because you're not watering and germinating weeds as much. You go down a bit, Steph. So that slide just shows you how much healthier and better the foliage grow under the drip rather than the sprinklers.
Keep in mind, this is 25% less water on the dragon line than the pivot's using. And we still have, we still had almost identical yield with less water. This was potatoes planted in South Africa when we started wondering if we could plant in circles with potatoes. Since we started planting, deciding we can plant in straight rows, we really don't plant in circles now. So if you go on to the next picture, I think we're about done with pictures there too. That just shows how the tubing will drag through the plant without hurting the plant. It doesn't even notice it's out there.
That's quite a question we get often is, so what damage does it do to the plants? And the guys in South Africa actually grew tomatoes with dragon line, and it didn't cause any damage in the tomatoes. So if it doesn't cause damage in tomatoes, you should be all right with any crop.
I think this is just showing them planting in a circle, which I would go ahead and go to the next slide. This by chance just shows the farmer that bought these systems didn't put dragline on the first system or on the first towers because he wanted to save the expanse and just use his traditional sprinkler heads. So even cutting back with water on the dragon line, this was the difference in yields that he had. He had about a 40% difference in yield with less water. You can see where the dragon lines drug across that roadway. But he has salinity in his water too, I believe, and he just didn't realize how much that was affecting his plants with the sprays from his sprinkler versus not wetting the leaves. Next slide.
Just to add to that, Monty, the guys in South Australia, Mark would know, they struggle a lot with high salinity in South Australia.
In particular, Tetaan, they struggle with chloride, which is absorbed through the leaves when they're wet. And we know with center pivots, if you have the surface wet with a misting windy day, you can get toxic levels of chloride in the plant tissue with moderately good water. And putting it in the soil instead of on the leaves reduces that.
Yep.
Next slide. I think that's, you go ahead, Tetaan.
Yeah, so that's just all the points we basically addressed. Water savings, eliminating the windrift. I won't say too much about that now. We've addressed most of those points. If you can go up a bit, Steph, please. These are photos we took in New South Wales. You can just see the amount of water that you basically lose from wind drift. A lot of clients want to compare bubblers with the drip. You can just see the infiltration difference between the drip and the bubblers, how much evaporation you're going to lose there. Go up a bit, Steph. Then the adaptability of dragon line. On the left there, we've got germination of lucerne in New South Wales. So very important in the way we water. Your management of the drip is totally different to your sprinkler packages. So what we've done there, the lucerne germination, we actually pre-watered the surface well. That's on very sandy soil as well. And our germination on that lucerne was absolutely fantastic. On the right-hand side, we've got 3.5 meter corn crop. So that's the beauty of the dragon line. We've got the hybrid system where you can lower it down and water low for low growing crops. And at the same time, you can, the next season you want to plant corn crop, you can raise the system to adapt to that. Next slide. That just shows you the wheel tracks and how dry the wheel track stays because you water behind the pivot. So your wear and tear on gearboxes so much less. On the right there, you can see germination of weeds, so much less. So at the end of the day, cost savings, it's not just water savings, it's chemical cost savings, your wear and tear, chemical use. So overall, it's not just the water savings we're looking at. That's a crop, a cotton crop in Finlay, New South Wales. Again, the sprinklers are putting down 25% more water content there. That grower grew a bale and a half more per hectare on the cotton crop. The return of investment, investing in the dragon line, was 12 months there. So question we always get is how much does the product cost and what's the investment gonna be? So unfortunately, it's very hard to say because each system gets custom made to the requirements, but anything from $900 to $1,500 per hectare. But the main thing there is your return of investment won't be longer than 3 years on the system, which is fantastic. Very good. Thank you, Steph. Monty, is there anything you would like to add?
I think you've covered everything well. You know, it just depends on the gallons and the reason why you're wanting to look at something different. It's kind of a two-edged sword. And when we start talking about gallons and efficiencies, whatever you're growing with today, we believe we can use 25 to 30% less water and do and maintain the same job that you're doing. If you're deficit watering and are really short of water, which that's how I developed this on my farm, because I only had 35 cubes of water and I watered 80 hectares with two pivots with that amount of water to develop this product. So I get twice the use of my water than I was before, and I can grow two systems of crops where I was limited to one without dragon line. So it's kind of a two-edged sword there, but most guys with potatoes have plenty of water, I assume. But if you can use 25 to 30% less, for every three circles you grow, you can grow one more basically free with the use of water for the savings that you accumulate. So I guess that's all I would ask Tetaan, and I'll turn it over to Mark now. Thanks, Mark.
Thanks, Monty, and thanks, Tetaan. I had a bit of a journey to get my mind around drip irrigation because I never really thought about it. And then we had the millennium drought, and we were up to 60,000 tons short at our factory in Tasmania with lack of water. And then I got sent to China for 3 years, and I did a bit of a study and found out the water we were pumping out of the ground was 10,000 years old and not being recharged. And then straight after that, I got sent to India. And I'll go to the next slide, Steph, and I'll talk about what I saw there. So this is not about dragon line yet. But in 2006, the Gujarat government in India realized that their ancient wells had dropped and it wasn't sustainable. So they got some Israelis in and they worked really hard, paid a pile of money and got most of the growers to change to drip. By the time I got there in 2013, most of the growers we dealt with were on drip. The wells had gone back to ancient levels. The growers were telling us that they were using 30% less water and their yield had gone up by 20%. Their power bills went backwards as well because you're pumping less water at a lower pressure. And foliar disease, like early blight and late blight, were no longer talked about. You know, they used to have problems with overhead irrigation in the heat in India with all these diseases. They went away. So that really made a big impact on me. And I then realized, of course, that you can see there with that giant reel of hard drip line, they roll out and roll up and they can use it for 15 years. That's not really doable on broadacre farming. They've got 2 acre fields and they do it. But so then I went to the next step. And if you can go to the next slide, Steph. So some drip take trials were encouraged by Scott Simplot in Idaho. He had a couple of guys working on it, and they worked with Netafim, and they were using the really thin disposable tape. And when you look at it, there's almost 12 kilometers of tape per hectare. And the tape's very thin, and they have a pile of little gophers and things that live in the soil there that chew holes in it, chew it to pieces. And if you've ever been in a big modern French fry factory and a piece of plastic turns up in a load, you'll know that hell breaks loose. It's just not an option. The other problem they had with this disposable tape was that, like almost everyone I've seen, including myself now, I have to admit I'm guilty of this. You know you have to use less water with drip, but you still over-irrigate. You end up with some rots and a few things like that, which just shows that it's easy to think, oh, I'll cut it back 20 or 25%. The experience I've had is you've got to cut back almost 35% or you're going to over-irrigate. So I got hold of some dragon line from Monty. You can see the orange tape there in the top left. And I tried a stationary trial where I put a pile of soil moisture monitors in there on some sandy soil. And I realized that while it's not being pulled along with the big drops, it can actually make some channels through the sand. So the movement thing's really important to this. If you're moving that dragon line along and it's dripping as it goes, it tends to go sideways once it goes in. So I learned a lot from the stationary trial. If we can go to the next one, Steph. So I don't know how I did it, but I tricked Monty into coming to Australia for a little while. He turned up. It was really great. And that's when I met Tetaan. He turned up with his father, and they worked like dogs for nothing for a few days to help out as well. And we installed the first system in Tasmania on a centre pivot to grow potatoes. It had just come out of broccoli. And it was our fault rather than Monty's fault. We didn't appreciate how big a problem the algal load in the channels. There was 10 kilometers of channels that brought the water from the Great Lakes to the pivot. It was even blocking up variable rate systems, variable rate pivots. So we fixed it in the end. But if I was talking to anyone, even though this is not as sensitive as normal drip, the holes are big and everything, for surface water in Australia, definitely get help on filtration. I think Tetaan's probably all over it now. So we had first go and we learned a lesson. We'll go to the next one if you like. So then we moved it onto a Simplot farming potato crop, and we put 30 hectares of dragon line, and we left a span of normal sprinklers operating. And it was designed so that the normal sprinklers put on 8 millimeters each pass, and the dragon line put on 6 millimeters, and that's a 25% reduction. And we actually did paired plots. We went to the sprinklers and then went a few paces across into the dragon line and did paired plots across the whole thing. And the dragon line won by at least 20% in yield. But we did notice on the heavier parts of the low-lying parts of the field that the dragon line didn't win. So we know we over-irrigated. So the whole crop was budgeted at 60 tons to the hectare by Simplot Farming, and it went 72. And I think eight to 10 tons of the 12 tons extra came from the dragon line effect. We didn't have a chance to notice a reduction in leaf diseases because it did get some drizzly rain at times. So I'm sure that if you're in an area that's fairly dry in the summer, you really can cut back on your fungicide sprays. If you get a bit of drizzle and rain or dew at night, maybe you still have to spray. Overall, it was a really good experience. The cost of electricity in Tasmania has become horrendous. And so it wasn't just the 25% or should have been 30 or 35% of water, it was the power as well. Okay, if you go to the next one. So the experience I had in India with drip sort of backs up what we're finding in Tasmania with dragon line, and that is drip irrigation will save you about 30% of water. It'll save you 35% of power. If you're in a fairly dryish environment, I think you can save around 50% of your fungicides. The yield improvement of 20%, I'm sure of that now. I'm starting to learn that potatoes and probably other crops as well, that if you seal the surface with an overall covering of water and you seal it, it gets a crust, you don't get oxygen into the roots. And there's something about soil that's still open that plants are a lot happier. They just grow better. You can actually see it from a long way off. You don't have to put bales of hay when you pivot, get bogged going up a hill. And I know that's a job a lot of our farms hate. And I first noticed it in India, where we lost a complete seed crop in the Punjab. We had all our seed in rice paddies, and they said it never rains here in the dry season. Well, it did rain. And the stuff that had overhead irrigation, and there were, you know, hundreds and hundreds of fields, all went rotten. And the ones that were drip irrigated actually came through it. And we worked out that little dry bit between the rows buys you 20 or 30 millimeters of slack when you get unseasonal rain. And I know even in the last couple of years in Australia, a lot of people have lost potatoes through heavy rain. And this is one way of having a bit of a buffer in there. I think I'll just go to the next one. I've got something I want to say about how it sets up in practice. When we first put it in, the plan was to put it in a pivot, then move it to the next pivot and chase the potato crops around. And if you're leasing land, you can do that. Monty said to me earlier that they've actually redesigned it, so it's a lot easier to move. But for some of our clients in Tasmania, the preference would be to put it on a pivot and leave it there. And they might have a five-year rotation. It could be carrots and peas and poppies and potatoes. And that's why the recent experience of a company called CSS in America, where they've bought, I think, 7 systems from New Monty, 7 center pivots now. They've come closer with the rows. And that really means that if you change crops, let's say broccoli's on 30 inches, potatoes on 34 inches, and you're not worried about following the rows anymore, it means you can just leave it there and keep going. In fact, I'd say that the spacing between your drip lines will have more to do with the type of soil you've got. Probably sandier soils, you need to come a bit closer. Heavier soils, you can get further apart. But if you're not having to follow rows, it's a lot more versatile. And in practice, for some people, that matters a lot. I had some growers saying, I'm going to put sheep in after the potatoes are harvested. What are we going to do now? They're going to trample the lines or something. Well, it's a pretty simple job to lift them up, put them on a hook. So there's a little bit there. The other thing to realize is, if you need to irrigate in a herbicide or water, some reason you want to use your normal emitters, they're still there. You pull a valve around, you've got these manifolds, but you can actually go back and have, so it's not or, it's and. You've got your normal emitters and you've got dragon line. And sometimes people do want to use their center pivot sprinklers for a specialized use, and it's still there. I think it's about all I've got to say. I don't sell dragon line or anything like that, but I see that for a company like Simplot that works in China where the water's going to run out, we work in India where it already did run out, and in Tasmania where people have got short memories, but we lost a lot, millions of dollars through running out of water in the millennium drought. This is something that I'm keen on because it'll underpin the long-term viability of what we're doing, I think. So we can go on from there if you like, Steph.
Thank you for that, Mark and Tetaan and Monty, for your inputs as well. So we're at the point now where we can take questions from anyone in the audience who's interested in asking anything to our presenters. And just if folk have a think about what they'd like to ask, I did have something, and perhaps Monty and Tetaan, you could elaborate, but what conditions or environments or soil types do you think the technology is best suited to?
With the ability to change row spacing, and also we can use different tubing with different spacing of emitters in the tubing, which allows us to water very clay soils with less water and increase the capillary action. On sandier soils, like Mark was alluding to, we put the spacing a little closer together where the water will percolate straight down and you don't have that side capillary action as much. But where we customize the system to fit the farmer, we want to be able to help him have the best soil health and plant health possible with the different ways to adapt our system. Maybe that's how I should say it. My first question to a grower is, well, I want to buy dragon line. What type of soil do you have? Do you have ungulating soils? And how many gallons are you using at this time? And then I'll ask him what his problems are. And usually we can figure that out in just a few minutes. He's either overwatering or not watering enough or inadequately with the direction with his sprinklers. So I guess that'd be how I would answer that to Don.
Yep. Agree, Monty.
So we've got a couple of questions coming in the Q&A function here. So the first one, how did you find the cloddiness of the soil at harvest under the drip line or dragon line system on heavier soils?
I can say from the experience in Tasmania, it was really good. You don't have as much energy in the water hitting the top of the soil. It's quite amazing how that energy gets transferred down and actually can compact soil. In fact, the other thing that we failed to say is from when the first drop goes on a plant to the last drop, it's 40 minutes. You've got 40 minutes of gentle irrigation. Whereas on the outside of a big center pivot, you've got 5 minutes to dump everything on it. And you can wash soil off the top and have green tubers and so on. And when you're just dripping on over 40 minutes, you don't tend to get that energy into the soil to compact it. So we harvested two potato crops that have grown from dragon line now, and they're both really good for that.
I might mention that if you about when you're watering with a sprinkler head or of some sort applying from the surface, whenever your water hits the soil, it melts the soil structure. And when you melt the soil structure, the clods, you start having settling out of the smaller soil particles into silt layers and compaction. And when you water with dragon line, we don't melt the soil particles. The water moves through the soil without melting the soil. And as you water, each time you water, the capillary action increases with the use of dragon line, which actually lifts the soil. And each time you water with conventional sprinkler heads, you're wetting and compacting the soil. And you can actually tell a difference walking in a field where you have sprinklers or you have dragon line. The dragon line will be soft and the sprinkler irrigation will be compacted. That's the reason you have runoff and compaction issues. So that's what I would say.
I'd actually say the key thing is the water stays where you put it. It doesn't run all over the place. Yeah.
So another question that's come in, how long is the drip line behind the pivot?
It depends on the gallonage that one is watering with, the gallonage or the volume of water. And then also the spacing that the manifold is made. For example, on a 76 centimeter spacing with 200 gallons, or I guess that'd be 35 cubes. You know, the outside links are about 15 or be 5 meters long. If you go to 38 centimeter spacing from there, then they'd be half that. You know, that'd be around that 2.5 meters long. So it just depends on the spacing of the manifold. But traditionally, they will never be more than 40 to 50 feet long. What would that be in meters? 15 meters, I guess.
Yep. In fact, Monty, I can remember the one that we installed twice in Tasmania. The outside of the pivot, they were around about 12, 15 meters, and then they get shorter as you come in, obviously, because it's going slower. Yep.
Yeah. The length of the tubing dictates how much water. They may only be 1 foot long at the start, and they'll be, like you say, 10 to 15 meters at the end. Yes.
And the other thing that's interesting to know is that orange tubing, and I don't know if you've changed it now, Monty, but it's so heavy duty and tough that if I had a 2 foot length of it, I could kill someone. It's actually really heavy duty stuff.
It's actually made now by Rivolus, which they've developed a completely new emitter just for us for this design. And it's even more robust, and you know, we have a 5-year warranty for it. You know, this is a tremendous warranty for anything you drag out on the soil. So that's the reason we've had experience of 8 years dragging on lucerne or alfalfa with 2,500 hours a year, and there's no wear on it. So we believe it'll last a long time.
There's a couple of questions that have come through around variable rate irrigation systems. So how does it work with VRI? And how does it work with variable textures? Can you use it with variable rate?
Good question. Usually people are using variable rate with either zone or time controlled because they have so many different soil types in their field and they're trying to accomplish more uniformity of watering. When we start using our mobile drip irrigation, our uniformity is so uniform. If you go on our website and look at some of our fields, to me, I don't think it's necessary at all to even look at variable rate irrigation whenever you have dragon line, because we apply the water so much more uniformly. We don't have the runoff and the compaction. I guess you could still use a VRI. I don't think it'd be necessary. And I think it'd be, once you see how it works, the uniformity is just beyond anything else that's out there to use.
There's another question that's come in as well. Did you see any benefit on specific gravity using less water?
I don't understand the question that well, Mark.
I was going to say this might be one for Mark potentially.
Yeah. I know in India that I was really surprised with the strong dry matter there. They only have 105 days season and it's winter time, and then the days are 9.5 hours long. So you've got short days, winter time, and 105 days. And we're getting SGs between 108.4 and 108.8. And I have actually read that drip, because you don't get the stop start stuff you tend to get with sprinklers sometimes, you know, sprinkler irrigation, anything in a potato that causes it to stop and start gives you a risk of growth cracks. It gives you a risk of hollow heart and also can mess with SG. And so you would expect, if you can keep the soil evenly wet and have good control of it, that you should actually get more reliable SG outcome.
Okay. There are no other questions in the Q&A, but Mark, when we caught up before this webinar to talk through the content for today, you mentioned in your experience the time that it takes at the start of the drip versus the end of the drip and the effect that has on a plant. Did you want to elaborate on that a bit more? And perhaps, Monty, you could add some comments as well.
Yeah, I know that in Tasmania, and it's probably the same in a lot of other parts of Australia, we end up not planting anything up to 15% of the area under a centre pivot because there'll be low-lying areas or areas where water ends up going to when it doesn't stay where you put it. And so a lot of that, I think, comes from big center pivots on the outside, especially when the water's hitting at 8 or 9 or 10 inches an hour instantaneous rate. Doesn't stay even. Sometimes it'll go through the sand on the top, hit the clay underneath, and still run somewhere. In fact, could you go back to my presentation and go backwards a few slides? There's a slide there that I forgot, a little video I forgot to do. Keep going backwards. It's the one. Keep coming down. Sorry. No. Down to the bottom. Yeah. That one. No. Number. Oh, sorry. You've gone past it. It's up now. 31 or something. Yeah, that one. If you could play the video, I don't know if we're going to be covering it with our faces there. There's a video there. And the video is of Scott Morris, who was Simplot Farming Manager at the time. And we'd done one lap on a dry field with dragon line. And we also had left the normal sprinklers on at 8 mils and the dragon line was on 6. And he had a penetrometer. And if you play the video, it's remarkable the difference between the two areas after just one pass. I can't see it because our faces are covering it, I think.
Yeah, it's playing on the right hand side. You can move the panel where the floating face is. Yeah. But the video did play. It's I'll play it again.
Yeah. So he's coming along here, and after one pass in his dry soil, one pass of dragon line, he pushed his penetrometer in a meter and he just couldn't believe it. So then he pulled it out and we got him to go next door where the normal sprinklers had been. And you can see the result there. He nearly bent the rod. He just couldn't get it in. And that just shows how drip irrigation water goes down and then sideways, where stuff you put on the top just seems to sit there and evaporate.
It's a pretty good demonstration there, Mark.
Yeah.
I think there's another question that's come in through the Q&A. With conventional drip, we are seeing tuber set very close to the center and top of the row, possibly impacting yield. With dragon line, are you getting more even distribution of tubers in the hill?
Actually, I hadn't seen an example of, unless they're using drip on sand where it's just going straight down and not going sideways. I mean, there's no doubt that the roots grow where the water is. Stolons don't come from roots, I know, but I hadn't noticed in India that they were having that issue. And I know that in our case, when you were digging the trial plots in the center pivots comparing the sprinklers to the drip, we didn't see a difference. So it sounds like the drip irrigation system that they're talking about is putting a narrow channel down. Yeah, I don't have an answer for that. That's quite unusual.
Okay. Feel free, Tony, if you're interested in coming off mute to elaborate, we can take you off. You can pop your hand up. Otherwise, if there are any other questions, happy to take them now. I've got a couple more that have come through. Have you tried it on lateral pivots?
Yes. Yeah, lateral pivots are most useful, I think most beneficial, because usually linears, when they're watering, they water their wheel tracks and then they can't go back the other direction. So they have to wait or shut off, and then they try to apply a lot of water going the other way because they can't come back in time. Where we don't wet the wheel track, we get very uniform watering, and so they can just reverse and go back the other way without wetting their wheel track or having a wheel track issue. All the dragon lines on the system are all the same length. They don't get shorter and longer as they go out, like on the center pivot, they're all the same length. So it's very uniform watering with the linear.
Monty, would you like to make a comment about doing a U-turn with dragon line, about flexibility and so on?
Pardon, Mark, I don't
know. Quite a few growers I know say, look, I'm only doing half a pivot and I'm going to have to come back. U-turn with the center pivot, yeah, with the dragon line.
Now, and that's one question people will usually ask, can you reverse with it? How easy is it to reverse? Part of our patent and the time it took to develop, we have a non-kinkable hose that starts off at the manifold that's about 3.5 meters long that extends to the ground and drags on the ground before the tubing attaches to it. And the purpose for that hose is so whenever you reverse, it'll curl around and go back the other direction without kinking the poly tubing that the dripper line is made out of. So whether you're reversing, it'll reverse and go the other way. Now, I might say, you know, just to clarify my comment here, if you're running without water in your linear and you reverse, you might have some kinking of your hoses, because when you have water in your hose, it'll never kink. But if it's dry, it could kink, you know, when you reverse. And you might have to go out and straighten out. Tetaan, I think you've had some issue with that. Maybe less than 10 on the whole system will kink, won't it? Very small amount.
Yeah, Monty, just a few might kink. So yeah, and you just walk along the line and just unkink them. So
the water in it, they never will kink.
Yep. The one thing we've noticed, we've got in Finley 200 hectares on the linear, and where normally they have got challenges that last sort of 20, 30, 40 meters where they're overwatering. So the crop actually get drenched and waterlogged. We've seen a major difference in that last sort of 30, 40 meters, the end of the system with the dragon line, where the whole crop is very uniform. So you don't get the water logging the same as what you get with a sprinkler. So it's definitely a big difference there.
Just another question. How has dragon line changed in the last 5 years? Maybe a question for Monty.
Yes, very good question. We have, during COVID, and also as I returned from Australia, I got home and I said, I've got to make this easier to install. So today we pre-cut, pre-measure, pre-package everything. So a typical 50-hectare pivot today, everything's pre-cut, measured, will fit in a, I don't know how to say it in metric, but a 4-foot by 8-foot crate will fit in a crate to ship anywhere in the world today. And also we've developed different winch systems that's more user-friendly to shift the system right and left. We've developed a new emitter. We've got different cabling systems to attach. So you can assemble a dragon line from the ground. You never have to get on a ladder anymore. Mark, remember getting up and down on the ladders all the time?
Oh, yes. Thank you very much.
My knee still hurts. But anyway, we've made a simple bar to reach up and hook on the cabling now without hooking pinch clamps and things on. And you can unhook them too, as easy. But we've made tremendous difference. We're shipping to 15 other countries around the world. And as we ship those, we can't send us someone each time to manage and setting that up. We just need to, we have a easy tutorial about an installation guide in several different languages. We have videos made. So we just had one gentleman with his 12-year-old daughter installed a system on 35 hectares in 3 days with him and his daughter. So we've made everything a lot more user-friendly to utilize, with a lot better materials, I will say that.
You know, Monty, I've just realized something we didn't cover here was fertigation, because one thing that struck me in India is that a guy might be living in a thatched roof house with 8 kids and one light gob bulb, but next door, the Israelis had put a little tin shed with a whole pile of venturi tanks with all the nutrients and a computer program. And their knowledge of getting the fertilizers just right through the drip was wonderful. They weren't spreading it out and trying to water it in and so on. Wherever the water went is where the roots are, and that's where the nutrition went. And they were using fairly low rates of fertilizer in the end. They were saving a lot of fertilizer by putting it through the drip.
We think on pivots, you'll save 10 to 20% of the use of the fertilizer, because usually you're trying to fertilize when you have canopy and you've got wind, and sometimes you can't pick the right time to fertilize, where we lay it directly on the soil. We even have some companies that are with rootworm chemicals to be applied with our dragon line, because we apply it on the surface, then it moves across the roots through capillary action, and they get more uniformity kill of the rootworm with dragon line than anything they've had. So you're absolutely right, Mark. There's a big difference in what we're doing there.
And you, I was going to say that I know that a lot of chemicals that we put on, or a lot of fertilizer, we put them on at a rate where if it's spread out on a hot day over the leaves, you're on the edge of burning them. And you might not damage your plant that much, but it does set them back a bit sometimes. And keeping some of this stuff off the leaves is a good idea.
We're going to eat a lot of that stuff you put on the leaves, so let's get it off the leaves.
That's great. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. So we've reached the top of our hour now. So I'd like to give a huge thank you to Monty from Dialing from the US, Mark and Tetaan for preparing your presentations today and sharing what you know and love about dragon line. And so the recording will be available on the website, and I'm assuming the best person to contact is Tetaan, is that right? If growers or anyone in the industry is interested in learning more for the context of Australia. I did want to just briefly let you know about a couple of events that we have coming up in the near future. So the PotatoLink team are organising a R&D forum on the 5th of June from 8:30 till 11 a.m., which is going to be held in Adelaide in linkages with Hort Connections, but you don't need to have a ticket to Hort Connections to come. We also have a field walk on the 5th of June as well, which is straight after the R&D forum. And the field walk is going to run from 12:30 till 2, and we've arranged a bus for anyone who is travelling from Hort Connections out to the field and a return. And then lastly, the Smart Farming Project, which isn't a PotatoLink project event, they've organised an additional event around sensors, a practical workshop for growers, which will be on the 6th of June. So the presenter of that workshop is also going to be talking at the R&D forum. So if you're joining the R&D forum and you're interested in hearing more about it, the following day there'll be something for you to learn a little bit more about. So that was all I wanted to share. Again, huge thank you to our presenters today, and thanks for those who've joined. And yeah, we look forward to seeing you at our next events.
Thank you, Steve.
Thank you.
Thank you.